Now to lamb. This is a stuffed shoulder of lamb, Judy. New Zealand lamb is ideal for this recipe, and it's nice and cheap. And to use something like a shoulder is well worthwhile, because it's much, much cheaper to stuff than a leg. Mm. I think this is about 50, just over, per pound, whereas a leg would be 80, just over. Mm.
And if it's frozen, which it obviously would be, a New Zealand lamb, then you must do it slowly, mustn't you?
Thaw it slowly. Indeed, yes. Because you can see this is absolutely bone dry, and that's because I thawed it slowly in the fridge.
Mm.
I've already taken the bone out, Judy.
Is that a difficult job?
Not really. There's the bone. Get your butcher to do it if you're at all nervous of doing it.
But otherwise, keep the knife absolutely close to the bone all the way around, and then it should come out like that.
Then it'll be nice and clean.
Yeah.
And I'm going to make a nice stuffing of breadcrumbs, 2 ounces of breadcrumbs, a small can this size of apricots chopped, salt and pepper, and a fried onion.
Which you've already partly fried, haven't you?
That's right. Mm. I find that to put raw onion in a stuffing makes it, very rarely does it get cooked in the time.
Mm.
And plenty of chopped parsley, 2 tablespoonfuls.
Lovely and green.
That's generous, isn't it?
I've just put some in the garden, is that all right?
I thought you meant you put it in here. Yes, I put some in a few weeks ago. I gather it's now still mild and it's still growing, and you should get it. I think you put a cloche over it and you get it at Christmas time.
Yes, and I'm hoping that's what's going to happen.
And then bind together with egg. 1 beaten egg.
Mm.
There we are.
Puts it all in.
Now it's got to be well seasoned, and then you'll get a good stuffing. So I've opened up where it's really sort of slitting the joint in half. I've opened it up, and then I'm going to put the stuffing in. Just going to squeeze it together. There we are. It's nice and moist. There we are. Put the lid over again. You take that bowl. Mm. Thank you. It's a real sticky job today, isn't it? Then you want to roll the joint up like that and tie it with string. And I've got one started, Judy.
Mm.
And I think that's easier than doing a whole long process.
Of course, you can skewer the lamb, presumably, now, if you just want to skewer it rather than tie it up professionally, as
you can.
Done.
A skewer is... Now, believe it or not, I've only got 2 short skewers left. My children are conquering at the moment, and
all children conquering?
They're bent, I found them. And also, I had to buy a brand new ball of string, because you know where that's gone. And bootlaces.
Yes.
Start off with making a knot. There's the end. Start off, it's like Christmas parcels, making an ordinary knot, a single knot, and then you use that as a slip knot for the end. So you would put that round the end, like catching a rabbit, and pull it up. And I've done that and started it all along here. Then you want to do this. Having done one slip knot, you put it underneath and then pull it like that, and you make a lovely pattern all the way down.
Very professional.
It's quicker with skewers, but you'll get it neater like that all the way down. You notice I didn't skin it, didn't need it, it wasn't tough. Turn it over with the stuffing in, and then you loop it
all the way down,
and then tie it at the end in a knot, like that, double knot, and then turn it over, and it's ready for roasting.
And when you roast it, you've got one in the oven, haven't you?
Yes. Roast it about 400 degrees Fahrenheit.
I'll come over with
you. Or a little bit lower.
Yeah. I didn't have any string yesterday either because of the conkers. I Mark's party to tie the balloons up.
There we are. The string's...
Oh, that looks delicious.
Still firmly holding it together, Judy. There's the stuffing oozing out, which looks rather nice. And it will take about 30 minutes to a pound. You can do it slightly less than 400 if you wish. There we are. There's that stuffing, Judy. Can you see?
Absolutely
the
super.
The lovely pink...
What would you serve that with, Mary?
I would cook potatoes and onions in the oven, layered in slices in the oven at the same time as I was cooking the meat, and that would save a bit of fuel.
What about the meat that we're going on to now? It's another piece of lamb, isn't it? But a different part this time.
This is the very cheapest part of lamb that you can get, and I think a jolly good buy. Now, a whole breast of lamb will maybe cost you about 15 pence, or That's in some butchers, or it's about 22 pence a pound for English or for New Zealand.
So in this case, you've bought English because they're the same price?
Yes. When you're buying one, make sure you buy quite a wide one. Mm. That's off a fairly big lamb, and then you've got more meat on it. Now, as you can see, they're not really very fatty, but before you start, you want to take off any surplus fat, because most families don't like an abundance of fat, and then you'll find in the top here, you see that piece there?
Yes. You take that out as well.
Just take that out and take this.
How do you...
Sharp knife.
Yes.
And off here, there's quite a big thick piece there. I don't like too much extra fat. And with a recipe that uses this breast of lamb, I find it best to start off by frying it. And here, the skin is quite smooth and not tough, and so there's no need to take it off. Sometimes it's dry, and if it is, you can just take it off with a sharp knife. Mm. Start off, this is red hot lamb. It's a spicy recipe, and start off by cutting the meat into slices.
What happens like when that. You get to the bone bits?
I'm just coming to that. Yes, you can do that quite easily, Judy. If you haven't got sharp knives, you can get your butcher to do it. You can sort of break it here yourself. Mm. I can. There we are. And just go through with a sharp knife.
Mm. And to prove it, she did it.
And to prove it, she did it. But you may find it a little bit tough, and if you do, then you can get your butcher to do it for you. Just slice it all the way down. Mm. But cut that into pieces. You can do pork in this very same way if you wish.
Like spare ribs, you mean?
That's right.
Now, you say you've partly cooked those already, have you?
Yes, fried? Because the outside is fatty, I've already started the recipe, and you need 2 pounds of the breast of lamb, and I've fried it well. That takes off the surplus fat, and it makes it all nice and crisp. So that's fried, and let's...
Is that in dripping? Is that your fried?
Yes, well, dripping's free. Mm. It's come off a joint usually, so those are all browned, and I've taken off any surplus fat. The little bit of fat that was left, I've started to brown the onions in, and that's taken up the fat, and I'm going to thicken it slightly with a little flour. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to use a tablespoonful of flour, level, and then we come to the other seasonings, and the reason why it's red hot, it's nice and spicy, is because it's got a bit of curry powder in, and I'm going to put a tablespoonful of curry powder.
Oh, now, goodness.
Well, that's not very much. You put much more in a curry, not a very generous one, according to how hot you like things. And 2 teaspoonfuls of tomato puree, and if you're only using a small amount of tomato puree, I find it best to
use the tube.
Yes, it's less wasteful.
Yes, I do too. Yes. And then keep the end rolled up like a tube of toothpaste.
That's right. So just stir those, just turn the heat up a second to absorb the flour. Put that in on top. There we are. Then to the other ingredients, a full can of tomatoes, and that's a 14-ounce can. 3/4 pint of stock.
That's meat stock, obviously.
That's right. And then pepper and salt.
I don't know what we do without those, do you?
And some onion, some carrot. That's optional. I've put a large carrot in sliced.
Mm. This takes a fair while to cook, doesn't it?
It does, and put a little garlic in if your family likes it.
One with your garlic crusher.
That's right. Yeah. I've left the skin on because I find that inside it collects the skin and I don't get my hands smelling of it.
Mm. How long do you... You can either cook that presumably in the oven or on the top, can you?
There we are. Yes, I usually cook it in the oven because I've got other things in the oven at the same time. Mm. Put the lid on and I usually bring it to the boil on top of the stove, and then put it in the oven and cook it slowly, 2 hours.
Today, actually, we're talking about pâtés. What is the difference? Sometimes, you know, when you go into these shops, which I think in France are called charcuteries, where you can buy pâté, what is the difference between pâté and terrine? Because the different labels confuse me.
Well, today, it's really the dish that it's cooked in. In the 18th century, it was, in fact, a pâté, had pastry around it, and was sometimes served as a pie, hot, and sometimes served hot as a minced pate, and a tureen was a tureen shaped dish.
I see. They're always as starters, really, these things, aren't they, for meals?
No, they're not. The first pate that we're going to do today, potter's pate, is lovely to have for lunch. We had it on Saturday. Even the four-year-old enjoyed it.
Really? That's as a main course. And, of course, obviously, let's go over and start to see how you make that. But then you'd serve it, what, with just with toast or French bread and salad?
Yes, a nice salad. We actually had some coleslaw with it because, at the moment, salad things are rather expensive. So, the joy of potter's pate is that it's made from few ingredients, so there's not a lot to remember, and the basis of it is in fact liver and sausage meat, and the sausage meat is already seasoned. It has a binding agent with it, and it's
and
very
herbs
good.
And things.
So you
it?
Use 8 ounces of sausage meat, 8 ounces of chicken livers, and that is actually the basis, and a large onion. Now you may laugh why I've begun to mince the onion with a bag over the top, but onions make me cry unless I do them underwater, or so I put a bag over so all the fumes haven't come up. And this is a portable mincer, so you don't need any special equipment necessarily. And if you just across the bottom of it, just dampen it, press it down on the table with a lock, and then we're away. So I've still got a little bit of onion to mince.
But in fact, of course, if you haven't got one of these, then you might have an attachment on a blender or a mixer if you have one.
That's right. And then to the other, and I take the bag off now because it doesn't smell anymore, and take off the elastic band. But I thought that was quite a bright idea because I was trying this pate out yesterday and I was streaming my eyes in the kitchen. I suddenly thought, I'll pop a bag on the end. So just
very
tip it out.
Clever idea, that.
Just a washed out clean bag, polythene bag. There we are in the bucket. And then the sausage meat, and I'm going to mash those together before I mince the rest. And there's herbs, of course. If you buy sausage meat, you can buy sausage meat with herbs in.
Which I can see that has, hasn't it?
And it's well seasoned.
Is pate good for freezing, Mary?
Well, not meat pates. I always use up within a short period of time. That is because it's got a high proportion of fat. In fact, a pate should have about half fat and half lean. So mash, first of all. You'll find it goes in better if you mash at the beginning like this, before putting the liver. We don't want to use too many bowls, so I'll mince the liver straight in on the top of this.
Can you have pate made of pretty well anything?
Yes, you can. You can do fish pates or meat pates. You can use the end of a carcass. If you have a roast bird, such as a chicken, or maybe a duck, you can use what's left and mince it through and then add other ingredients. Now the livers sometimes come attached to the heart, as that is, and so take it off and any little bits of fat. So put the liver into the mincer, and these are chicken livers, and often chicken livers are very reasonable. Let's wipe my hands.
And easily bought in chain supermarkets.
That's right, or good butchers, because they usually have them, and they usually come in 8 ounce packets, so we're using 8 ounces of liver.
So it's equal amounts, 8 ounces of sausage meat and the 8 ounces of chicken liver.
Yep. That's right, and then the rest of the liver in.
I think you said you could make pates from rabbits to larks or something.
Yes, you could make a packet of pate of anything from In France, it's a lark or rabbit or venison, game, anything, as long as you've got the proportion right. And later on in the programme, I'm going to be making a true French pate with some nice fatty belly of pork that's salt. You've got to be careful of the seasoning. There we are. So all that remains is the seasoning now. And I find using sausage meat that I use about a teaspoonful of salt, plenty of black pepper. I think technically that would be about a quarter of a teaspoonful. And then garlic. There we are. Thought I'd lost it. It's beginning to sprout at the moment. That must be the time of year. Just press
Spring.
It through the garlic mincer. Mm. Now you'll notice I didn't put that through the mincer because it wouldn't have been fine enough. There we are. And then a good bunch of parsley, that's about a tablespoonful. lots of green. And no herbs in this one because sausage meat has got one. And also this is very much, Potter's Patty is a family patty and every member of the family will enjoy it.
I think the great thing about it is the sausage meat takes away that very strong taste of liver, which you can sometimes find in
That's
some
right.
patties where the proportion is greater of the livers.
Now, Judy, to the lining of the tin, I find that about five, it makes extra moist if you use some bacon in the bottom. But if you're being very economical and you want it just for lunch, you can not line it with bacon, but it does make it extra moist. Then just, I've put two in already, just stretch these out a little bit.
That's streaky rashers.
That's right. Now you notice me break that one, I shall carefully put that one in first. I put four in. And the tin has been greased well with lard. And that just makes it extra nice when it's turned out.
Is that unsmoked or smoked bacon, Mary?
This was unsmoked, green bacon.
Mm.
There we are. Just room for that last one. Now to pouring it in. This is actually a 1 pound tin which takes about a pint of liquid. And you can do it in any tin, you can do it in a tureen, you can do it in a tin. And if you do it in an earthenware one, remember it'll take a little bit longer to cook.
Because it's got to get through.
And fill it right to the top.
The heat.
There we are. And it looks rather appetising with that nice green parsley.
Looks very good, that.
And then over the top, put a piece of foil. You may have a lid, but on this particular one, I haven't got a lid. There we are. And then I'm going to put that to cook in a tin of water. And so fill the tin with warm water halfway up the tin. That's a meat, just an ordinary meat tin, Judy.
Mm.
And then just fill it halfway up.
That's just so it doesn't go dry.
That's
the
right,
end.
It keeps it extra moist.
Mm.
There we are, halfway up the tin. No more, because of course it would boil into the actual pate. And I'm going
right.
to bake that.
Mm. How long do you cook that for, actually?
Now, that is in a metal tin, therefore it'll be between an hour and a half at 325, gas number 3. Then take it from the oven, and as it comes out hot from the oven, put a piece of wood. Now, this is beautifully made. It can be thick plywood, anything. Just shape to the inside of the tin. That's what it looks like when it comes out of the oven. Then you've still got the foil on it there.
Mm.
And then put your block of wood, which fits the inside of the lid, you see.
Mm.
Press that down and then put weights on top. In this case, not too heavy. Just push it down until you just see the juices coming up to the top.
And that knits it all together.
That keeps it firm, and then it won't crumble when it comes out.
Mm.
And then let it get stone cold, and then turn it out.
Mm.
So obviously that has been in the fridge overnight, and it's ready to turn out now.
Another beauty about pate, of course, is that you can do it the day before easily, can't you? And then you've got your main part of your meal, as you say, you can use this as a main course, all ready without last-minute rush.
And also it is better, Judy.
What, to leave it?
Yes. It'll come out.
Yes, there it is.
I always say it'll
lovely.
Come out. It usually does, doesn't it?
Jolly
if not, we'll give
good.
It a good prod.
Yeah.
There we are. And the bacon does make it look much nicer.
Mm.
And it's just the finishing touch. Then perhaps a little parsley on the top.
Beautifully dressed. Shall I take that
And it'll
that
keep
in?
Well in the fridge for 3 or 4 days.
Mm.
And freeze if you must, but not for too long.
Right. I'll put that over here.
There we are. Lovely. Thank you very much.
Funny how a bit of green like that just dresses it up so nicely.